And if I can use this as a little bit of a segue, I think the bottom line is the reason why some people can see the fact that miracles exist now and the reason why some people can't is because of their presuppositions. And that being said, I would like to. You like that one?
I love that. That was good. That was very good.
Very, very smooth.
I would like to address the fact that I'm under the belief that everybody has presuppositions, but there are some people on the atheist side that will sometimes argue that they don't have presuppositions. And of course, this all comes down to arguing with Christians that are of the presuppositional apologetic flavor. So, of course, you know, this isn't something that comes up randomly in normal conversation over coffee or a beer where people are saying, no, I don't have presuppositions. It is because the very foundation of presuppositional apologetics is the idea that everybody has presuppositions. From these presuppositions are spawn worldviews, and from these worldviews, certain assumptions can be made and certain critiques can be made, yada, yada. So they want to nip it at the bud, I think, and just say, nope. That doesn't apply to me because I don't have any presuppositions. Now, I know Ozzy has some opinions about this.
Yeah, go ahead, Ozzy.
Yeah, I do. I had a discussion yesterday with someone, and it seemed to me symptomatic of a tendency from those on my side of the atheist-theist divide, my fellow atheists. We have a tendency to assume that we operate upon beliefs that are fully supported by evidence, and this, as I see it, is just inaccurate and self-congratulatory as self-description. I think it's more motivated by a horror of the idea that one might actually believe things on insufficient evidence, which is sort of the allegation that those of us sort of in the atheist skeptical movement like to lay at the doorstep of believers, people who believe in religion, people of faith, you know, people who are superstitious, people who believe in the paranormal. You know, we like to think that, you know, we live in the kingdom of reason and they believe things on faith. And I think one of the things that's happening is it's as if we're, as a result of arguing with people who embrace faith, we become allergic to the word faith, and the idea of having poorly supported or unsupported beliefs, and we're driven to deny that any of our own ideas can be shown to be unsupported or without a good or even any evidentiary foundation. I think that's wrong. I could list a whole pile of things that I think that we all take on faith. But the argument that I think needs to be made here against that tendency is that, as I see it, faith-based assumptions or presuppositions, or as I would call them, properly basic beliefs, okay, as opposed to, you know, most other faith claims, properly basic beliefs, such as the belief that there is a mind-independent reality, that there exist other beings out there that have other minds, namely people, that you can trust in induction, you can trust in deduction, you can trust the evidence of your senses, you can trust in your memory, that there is such a thing as good and evil. All of these things, I think, are properly basic in that they form the very ground of rationality. They constitute what reasonableness and rationality are. They constitute it. They're not by themselves, though. None of those things that I just mentioned are by themselves defensible by the articles of faith themselves. That would be arguing in a circle. And there's no meta-rationality. There's no other rationality outside of that to support our rationality. So I think that the acknowledgement of these properly basic beliefs, or call them presuppositions, in no way licenses a person to believe any old thing. And I think that's the concern that people have. That's the worry that people on our side of the fence have, that if we admit that we have beliefs that aren't themselves born of evidence, we're going to be handing others a license to believe any old thing without sufficient evidence. And I think this is a huge mistake, and I think that we discredit ourselves and we disqualify ourselves as proponents of intellectual honesty and intellectual modesty and reason when we do this. I think we need to own up to where our own epistemic limitations are.
I agree with that
I agree.
Yes. You know, it's so
good
true.
Stuff.
But I think that also one of the problems that has provoked that is that there are many people who, and you know, although I am a theist, there are many theists who hold on to some of their presupposed concepts quite in the face of far more reliable and demonstrable truths that they are basically in denial of. And so, I mean, it's one thing for two people of two different worldviews to have a difference of opinion as to what explains things, but it's quite another for, you know, for us to come up with an artificial standard of saying this is two cups and arguing over whether something is two cups or something. You know, unfortunately, people of faith are very guilty of holding on to faith as if what they believe in has some power or right to trump the reality that is the experience of others in an empirical manner.
Yeah, I think it is also a question of language. I wouldn't use the word faith. I would say it's a degree of confidence. In the secular world, because I think that faith is so loaded in terms of being associated with a religion. I think that when we look at, from an atheistic point of view, when we express an opinion, we're not, I think, saying that we have faith in that opinion. We have a degree of confidence.
Right.
And that degree of confidence can be graduated, you know, to a low level of confidence, high level of confidence, and what have you. And I think that in terms of what Ozzy is saying, in terms of saying that we don't want to have presuppositions, it's a very defensive thing, and it is misplaced. I agree, it is misplaced. We all have presuppositions that we have to work from. But I think it is very defensive because presupposition now itself is such a loaded term. It's associated with the likes of Mr. Ten Broekhuis. And it's such a shame.
That's quite unfortunate, but I think when I'm using the word faith and presupposition, I'm not talking about, you know, if I say I trust in a certain scientific theory or something like that. I mean, that I think is properly termed confidence. The things that I was sort of that I enumerated as articles of faith, I think, really, I mean, philosophers have been grappling for millennia, trying to make, you know, well, centuries for some of them, but millennia for some of the others, trying to sort of, you know, shore up these ideas, defend these ideas. The idea that there's a mind-independent reality, that's actually hard to defend. I mean, it sounds preposterous. Like, really, it's hard to defend the idea that there's an external world outside my mind? Well, yeah, because, any evidence that you could adduce in favor of an external world could just be the product of your imagination, right, could just be happening in your mind. Yeah. So solipsism, this idea that the world is, that there's only one mind and you're the mind. You know, there's no way around that. So that's why I think it's an article of faith. We just all act as if there is a mind-independent reality and that ours is not the only other mind. And So the things that I'm enumerating, I think, really are, in the strict sense of the word, pure articles of faith. We cannot defend them using anything else in our belief set. We just do start from these things. They are, as I say, properly basic. But I think sort of belief in God, belief in the supernatural, I don't think that's properly basic. I think you can literally evacuate that from your worldview, and you're fine. Everything holds. I think that, and it's one point I would like to make is that there are some philosophers, Alvin Plantinga in particular is a noted philosopher who is a theist in the Reformed tradition, but a noteworthy philosopher. He argues that belief in God is properly basic, that so much of a person's worldview is hooked into the God belief that you cannot extricate it. And I think it's wrong. And I think one way to demonstrate that is just like you can find people who think that, and then some of them lose their belief in God, and they discover that the center holds, that, you know, they continue to have moral beliefs, they continue to have values, they continue to believe in knowledge, they continue to be able to love people, and everything goes. And sort of the analogy I use for this is, think of your set of beliefs as a tapestry, as an enormous, elaborate, beautiful tapestry. with fibers going every which way. And then it's as if there's a pattern in that tapestry. There's like one silver thread that runs all the way through it and makes this beautiful picture, and it enriches the tapestry in your mind. And what an atheist such as myself is suggesting is that you can take that silver thread and you can draw on it, and you can pull on it slowly and tug it out. And there might be resistance, like the tapestry might bunch up, you know. But if you pull gently enough and tug it out, you can extract that thing completely, and the tapestry is intact. But as you're doing it, the person who owns that tapestry, whose belief set that is going to just freak out and go, no, 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 you can't do this. You're going to wreck it. Everything will come apart. The tapestry will be ruined. And what we're trying to assure people, those of us on my side of the fence, is that no, 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 there really are threads in there that have to stay, that are properly basic. But this one, the silver thread you cherish so much that seems so integrated into everything else, it's all one thread and it all comes out. That's a hard sell, and I can understand why people think it belongs there.
Ozzy, I'm curious if you would understand. I think that it's interesting, and you point out certain presuppositions that are you just can't operate without, such as the non-solipsistic presupposition. Is it possible that just as MK was talking about degrees of certainty or confidence, that there are also degrees of essentialness to certain, because I think we're all set into our lives with the need to make certain decisions. And we can't always gather all of the essential information in order to make an absolutely certain decision. There comes a time to make a decision, a time to act in order to live one's life. And as a result, we have to move along in life, recognizing that we can't verify everything. We can verify the verifiable, perhaps, or the issues that are urgent or most important. But don't we all really live a great deal of our lives on things that are taken by faith and aren't really necessarily essential aspects of faith that one could do without? So it seems to me there's actually even a degree of this element there. I agree with your basic concept there, but I would think there is room for us to realize that there's room for more faith than just that.
Yeah. No, I would agree. There are degrees of – I think where the things that I was sort of carving off as articles of faith, I think are pure articles of faith. We really cannot do it without those things. If you abandon those things, you become incomprehensible to other people. Like you live, people don't
exactly.
You can't even make sense of your own thoughts. You can't sort of predict what you're going to do from one moment to the next. You couldn't decide to go to the fridge to fill your face because you wouldn't be able to correctly infer that eating would satisfy your hunger. Everything would fall apart. Most things that we take on faith are not like that. It's much more a matter of degree. And that, I think, is where things sort of blur into confidence. And so I think that we have a few things that we take absolutely on faith that we are really quite indefensible, all of us. But then there's all these other things that we take on faith that, well, some of us have to take these things on faith, others don't take it on faith, and then there's all these degrees. And then hopefully we get it. I'm not terribly worried about the fact that I have beliefs that are poorly supported. The mark of rationality to me is not having beliefs that are perfectly supported or strongly evidenced. It's you just want your confidence in your beliefs to scale or be commensurate with the evidence. I have beliefs that I feel are very strongly supported, and I'm very confident
with the relevance. With the relevance as to whether or not it even matters. If we're going to be rational people, there may be some things we're moving in confidence, and since there's no real consequence to it, the moment may never occur where I have to really give this some thought. So who cares, of course, as you know, I call myself an agnostic theist, and part of that means that I can't conceive of a God that would require you to be conscious of him, I would not put God consciousness in an essential article of faith.
And I think that you're bringing up something, Ozzy, that's not made explicit, so I would like to make it explicit. The things that you're talking about are the things required of all humans in order to make sense of
Definitely.
Their of their psychology, cognition, or philosophical endpoints in any way, shape, or form. And that's what you're talking about. And you are, you know, a studied man in philosophy. So when I saw you have this discussion with the person you had the discussion with the other night, last night, I couldn't help but see the imbalance of what was going on. It would be like somebody who was talking about cognitive psychology, telling somebody like, hey, this is how the brain works, and them going, not knowing anything about cognitive psychology, going, nope, not me.
Yeah, I think I was guilty of sort of talking over somebody's head there, and that's entirely my fault, because one of the things about when you study something closely for a long, long time, certain things become very obvious to you, and they almost seem to go without saying, and there's nothing at all obvious about them. And the fellow that I was talking to was perfectly intelligent and perfectly reasonable, but I was at pains to sort of make my point clear, and sort of distinguish it from the concerns that he had about the word faith and the term presuppositions. I was largely at fault there for not seeing what others weren't seeing, because it was just a little too obvious to me, because it's something I've thought about long enough. And it's unfortunate when that happens. Fortunately, there were other people in the room who could better appreciate what I was failing to understand about the obstacle that he had, and they were able to sort of clear things up. So I think my point was actually better made by other people in the room who were there than by anything I could say.
But you know,
I like what Bob said about the occasion. So go ahead, Bob.
In America, one of the weaknesses that we have here is that we do not have a strong multicultural experience. I mean, we have ethnic groups here in America, but we don't know what it's like. For example, we don't go to Vietnam and live there. We don't go to the Brazilian bush and live there for a year and discover that anthropologically other cultures operate on a whole different set of assumptions and values about life and freedom and this and that. And as a result, we're blind to the things that we assume to be just de facto. You know, we're blind to that. And I think that that's also a big part of why American religion has been so easily fundamentalist, you know, whereas at least in Europe, where there's a closer connection with people who actually do speak a different native tongue, you know.
I want to bring Michael Fulford into the conversation, and what do you think about the conversation at hand, Michael?
It's very interesting. I mean, I'm not as well read in philosophy as other people are, so I'm trying to just kind of catch in as they're talking. But there's a point, like Ozzy's saying, we do have certain presuppositions, and it becomes difficult to argue that if you're an atheist used to debate, because people will take presupposition to be the presuppositionalist argument for God. Many presuppositionalists will use that term as a way of backing into their argument and as verifying their own position. When you get to where you do debate regularly or you interact with people regularly, things like belief and presupposition take on a definitely a very negative view because of that.
Definitely.
And, you know, it ends up being you have a definition of belief and I have a definition of belief, and I can accept my definition of belief, but I can't accept your definition of belief. And it does cause
a
problem.
Well, it's kind of like this conversation tonight. I've been sitting back not saying anything, and I've heard faith used in at least five different mm-hmm. ways. Mm-hmm. And so it becomes extremely complicated trying to get on the same page, talk mm-hmm. about apples to apples. And so it's been a wonderful conversation, but this is just the way that language works. Mm-hmm. It's clumsy in a sense, and it takes time. And so we're so thankful to have people here who are willing to put X, Y, and Z together. Now, Ozzy, you guys were really engaged in something that I think was one of these game-changing conversations. So could you turn up the heat a little bit and give us some of the goodies you were putting out?
I'm not sure what you mean.
Go.
Well, from what I understand from Christopher Mowdy, he would not have asked you to talk about this particular subject unless something was making lots of wow points.
Oh, well, geez, I don't know how. Maybe Christopher could do a better job of this. Can I turn this over to Christopher?
Because, come on.
Okay.
Come on, Ozzy. Push it.
Okay, well,
do you really want me to play the theist that really pushes you so you'll push back on me? I don't need to do that. Come on.
No, this discussion came out of an argument that I had last night with another atheist who was presenting. We were talking about presuppositionalism. And he characterized presuppositionalism in a way that I thought was inaccurate, and I've sort of been making a nuisance of myself in these sort of no. Some of your objections to presuppositionalism are wrong. You're tilting at windmills because there's these people out there who are just sort of butchering the presuppositionalist argument. And even at that, some of the arguments you're putting forward are wrong. And he took great umbrage at my allegation that he didn't understand presuppositionalism, it got interesting. So
and it certainly wasn't
trying to be very innocent of what presuppositionalism was.
I think.
No, go ahead, Chris. What would we say?
I was going to say it certainly wasn't the fact that it got passionate or overheated or anything like that, but it got frustrating. Now, I got into the same hangout that he's talking about a little bit later, and I didn't know exactly what the context was, and all I could see was Ozzy kind of having at it with this other person that I knew was an atheist as well, and I'm like, wow, this is interesting. What's going on here? And it was after listening for a little bit, it was, and this is why I brought it up, because I think it's really important. It was essentially Ozzy being a steward for the position that he holds, and ensuring that there was no poisoning of the well from other people that had the same label as the position he holds, misrepresenting ideas in such a way that would besmirch that label. And that's what I thought was interesting about.
Oh, I see. I see what you're getting at. Yeah. Okay. Well, here's one of the things that I don't like in these debates. I mean, I have a vested interest in this. I am an atheist and a skeptic, and so, you know, when I'm arguing my position with a theist, I like to try to present the best arguments that I can in favor of my position and the best arguments I can against their position. And one thing I don't like encountering or having is someone on my side arguing, presenting what I think are bad arguments. I think that, you know, nothing undermines your case worse than a bad ally. And this fellow is very smart. And so it's all the more, I don't know, irritating to me to have a really smart fellow who's been having these arguments for a long time on the wrong side. Theism isn't my enemy. Irrationality is my enemy, and with all due respect to everybody here who's a theist, I think that every form of theism is a species of irrationalism, a species of superstition. You know, theism itself is fairly innocuous and doesn't concern me. There are specific religious beliefs, specific doctrines that I think pose serious liabilities to us in our society that I think we need to combat. I'm not concerned. Theism doesn't motivate anybody to do anything. Atheism doesn't motivate anybody to do anything. But an atheist who has certain other beliefs can do a lot of damage and a lot of harm and a lot of mischief. And the same thing with a theist who has certain specific pernicious beliefs can get up to a lot of mischief. So I'm not too worried about, you know, theists and atheists, but when I'm arguing something like this and I'm pushing I'm trying to get people to sort of be as rational as they can be, and I don't care where the bad arguments are coming from, where the good arguments are coming from. You just want good arguments on either side. And I don't like my side being polluted with what I see as bad arguments. And I expect other people to do the same to me. If they think I'm out to lunch on this or anything else, I expect them to call me on it. And I just wish that in this theism-atheism dialogue, if people could keep their own side honest, it would do more. I think I can do more to sort of persuade my fellow non-believers to argue better and up their game than anybody on the other side can do. Right? And similarly, people on the other side have to keep their side honest because, look, they're not going to take me in my word. They can't trust me. I'm the enemy, so to speak. Right? So we need to police our own. And all I mean by policing our own is merely just being critical of one another and trying to keep ourselves honest and not play the game of any old argument will do. Right? We don't want to do this by any means necessary in these discussions. So in the interest of intellectual honesty, this is what we want to do. We want to make sure that we keep our own side honest because the other side's not going to do it for us because it's not very effective when the other side tries to correct you.
I disagree with some of what you're saying simply because when I look at my side and I used to think that I had a side and I don't think that I have a side any longer, but maybe I do. I may be confused about this. But when I look at theists, and I look at the possibilities of getting theists to be honest, I think that's almost incomprehensible, to be honest with you. I don't think that it's going to happen in my lifetime. However, I do think that you're trying to say that, you know, to clean up your own backyard, trying to encourage theists, if you will, to be honest, that is difficult.
Well, that's what you do every day here.
Well, I agree, but it's I don't know, and please help me. I really do need some help in this because when I'm trying to get theists to be honest about the text, I strike out most of the time. I can say X, Y, and Z, and it's like it can't be done. I'm not saying that it's impossible.
I get written off more often than not when I try to speak to other theists. It's really as soon as they discover the degree to which you want to confront some of their bad arguments, there comes a moment in time where they just have to kind of pull the plug on you.
Exactly. You know, I probably identify with more atheists than I do theists, and I find myself just wanting to look at the facts. There are times in which I really don't even want to refer to myself as a theist, and I'm not backing away from anything because the way that I look at the text, and this is always the issue in theism, it's a textual issue. And when I look at the text, I see that these people are wrestling with things that theists are not even talking about. And I really don't think the atheistic community is talking about it either. And so I think it's a little bit complicated. And I think Bob would agree with my position on this simply because I think that we need to take a scientific approach towards the text. And in doing so, I think that we become even more honest with the text. With that said, we are actually wrestling with what theism is in the most honest of ways. And it does come with things that we can deal with empirically, and then it comes with things that, you know, just have to do with, you know, these experiences that we do have. And so can you help me a little bit here, Ozzy? I would really appreciate it if you could help me to wrestle with what you're calling my side.
Yeah, well, I need to qualify that because it's apparent from how you were reading my words that I wasn't being very clear. By my side, I don't mean the side of atheists. I mean the side of people committed to reasonableness and rationality.
Okay.
And there's plenty of people who are religious who are exquisitely rational. I think where they're irrational is they've compartmentalized. They've simply not applied the standards, the very high standards of reasonableness and rationality that they employ daily in every aspect of their lives to certain, you know, we all do this. We all have a tendency to do this. We all do it, you know, to our political beliefs. It's amazing how rational we can be. And yet when it comes to our political beliefs, boy, you know, the wheels come off, you know, somehow.
I agree.
So the side that I'm talking about here is the side of rationality. And I think that one of the byproducts of that rationality is less religiosity, a tendency towards atheism, or at least a very honest agnosticism. Now, you're in a very difficult position, but I think you're also in a privileged position. You know, if you know what you know about the text, you're an expert on the text. I'm not an expert on the text. And people on my side, people who are not religious, okay, who are rationalists, but who are not religious, are not going to be the best people to try to sort of disabuse other people of their naive ideas about the Bible and their sacred writings. It's just, you know, we're just not the people to do this. I think that has to come from a more internal discourse. People who are theists and who self-identify as theists and Christians who love the Bible. I mean, I'm kind of weird. I'm an atheist who loves the Bible. I love to read the Bible. I love to reread the Bible. I like to think about it and study it and read about it. It's kind of peculiar, but, you know, I don't know enough about it to do the kind of work that you would do. You are uniquely positioned to do this. The problem is, of course, that people that you want to reach most are the people who are so wedded to it, and values and morality are entangled in this. That's what's at stake for them. You're not just sort of taking away a philosophical belief. If it was only a philosophical belief, you would have no trouble. It's not a philosophical belief. It's not even something they probably reasoned their way into. It is just the furniture of their world, that this is the Word of God. You know, to say that the Bible is the Word of God to them is a truism. So, and because values and morality are inextricably bound up, I think what has to happen is you have to sort of sell them on the idea that not everything's going to fall apart for them. But I don't know how you could do that. Right. I mean, I know how I would do that as a philosopher, or someone, I'm not a philosopher, but as someone who has a background in philosophy. So,
yeah. In some ways, our real challenge here is to try to deal at times with other theists, to try to show them that their approach to the biblical text is irrational, is not based upon a knowledge of language, of how it works, and there's a sense in which I would say that I think that Dr. Jones and I are both very much convinced that the cleaning up the theistic side of this all involves really dealing with the text, because it is somehow, that's the kingpin. To the degree that these people believe that they have an inerrant text that actually comes from God, this is the degree to which their fears, their superstitious fears of letting go of something that actually comes from God, is too big a risk. And to confront them, though, with the way that they're not being honest about language use, language development, language acquisition, language usage, to deal with this, it's our hope that we can find people who, it, just like you said, you know, you would take away all these threads, you discover it still holds together. There is a theism that can still hold together, even still honor the apparent mission of Jesus, without having to do that, and it becomes a very, a weaker, less dogmatic kind of it. Totally non-dogmatic, but that's really what we're trying to do in cleaning up from our side is deal with that issue from the language standpoint.
And I do want to make it clear, Ozzy, that when you were talking a while ago, I want you to know that I feel like I'm very much on your side, and I didn't want you to leave me out. I didn't want you to put a line in between you and me in that sense of the word. And so,
I think you're on my side.
Well, I'm definitely a theist, but probably not typical. And sometimes I even wrestle with the thought of not being called a theist. I would rather be called, just a human being. You know, hello, Michael. How are you doing? That's fine with me. I don't know. I'm getting tired, if you will, of over usages of terms like atheism and theism and God terms and yada, yada, yada. And so I love where you're going with this. You're talking about rational thought, and we're talking about honesty. We're trying to walk into a world that's actually maybe wrestling with the concept in a better manner, maybe possibly defining honesty more clearly. I really don't know if we have a clear definition of what honesty is. I don't know, you know, and I'm being very, very open with you tonight.
Yeah.
Well, honesty's hard. Go ahead. Go ahead, MK.
Yeah, I was actually going to jump in support of the theists. What I know when I'm sort of engaging on forums is that I see an awful lot of atheists coming on board who don't engage in rational argument against theists. They do bring a lot of emotion. They may well be new atheists who had been theists and have embraced a certain level of enthusiasm in their atheism, which exceeds their ability to rationally put together an argument. And their reaction when they are pulled up on it is sometimes quite extreme to another atheist. How dare you tell me that my interpretation of this particular piece of biblical text is wrong? It does say that. It is offensive. And you sort of have to say, no, calm down. You are making a really basic mistake. If you're going to go in with into an argument with a theist, articulating that line of argument, they are going to cream you. Mm. You know, scale it down, do a bit of research. If you want to make that point, make it better. So I think that from the atheistic side, yeah. But equally, from the theistic side, and I would quote somebody like Jason Burns, you do see people coming in from the theistic side equally with enthusiasm and less rationality. So I don't think it's necessarily the fault of one side or the other. I think that when we get into these sorts of discussions, going in almost on different levels, and it's, I think sometimes you have to find the right level of opponent in order to have a meaningful discussion. I don't think that everybody on the atheistic side has the degree in philosophy, perhaps, to be able to articulate an argument properly. And consequently, yeah, sometimes there can be more emotion than necessary.
Even the cultural knowledge, sometimes an atheist will try to point out what they perceive as contradictions in the Bible. And I'm certainly not going to stand here and tell you there aren't any. There certainly are. But some of the apparent contradictions in the Bible are really just cross-cultural, cross-time differences in the way things are said or done or understood. And as a result, it's really misunderstanding and miscommunication rather than contradiction. And unfortunately, when you try to point that out to maybe a Bible-embracing believer, when they know better, you end up only just leave. They run off thinking, see, like they said, you guys are just blind. You're the Holy Spirit, and you know, it only becomes proof to them, confirmation to their own bias.
Yeah, I know that when I was beginning to question my religion, one of the issues I found very quickly is I became an atheist of the Christians before I became an atheist myself, simply by questioning what I've been taught. Mm-hmm. There is a kind of a self-defense reaction as soon as you start questioning something that somebody holds so closely to them. And to go to the like Paul was mentioning, the new atheist, one thing I've noticed is that, Ozzy, have you ever been online on any of the skeptic forums?
Yeah, I have.
And what I've found, there are many different forums that have a large differences in populations. The U.S.-based skeptic forums are very different from the ones that are based in Europe, and there's a decent difference between those and the ones based out of Australia. In fact, I kind of prefer the ones from Australia most of the time. They're usually more relaxed. When I go to an atheist forum, one that's strictly for atheists, I find that there's a big difference. There's much less willingness to discuss ideas, much less of a reaction where if someone's making a bad argument, they'll be called on it. Much more of a just people piling in and arguing. In fact, I'm a member of a forum just earlier. I was checking it, and a person decided to check out because he would not be allowed to just insult religion. Mm-hmm. And I mean, he's made good arguments and provided good information, but the fact that he was, they have a rule stating you can't just make fun of religion here. You have to do more than that. He just left in a huff.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned these forums, Michael, because I stopped participating in those fora for I haven't been back actually, precisely because there was so much of that. And when I used to participate in debates and not formal debates, but just discussions on IRC, there were never any. Well, sometimes there were formal debates, but I never participated in those. But when I participated in those discussions, I did that for about 10 years. I never hung out on the atheist channels. I hung out on the religious channels and Christian debate discussion channels and apologetics channels and some skeptical channels and general debating discussion channels, you know, but never in the atheist channels because it was just too much of that. I couldn't do that. And when I did go on the atheist channels as a kind of experiment, I did this thing. It's a little bit shameful, but you always have to log in as a under a username. You have to make up a handle, and mine was Deus Irae, Wrath of God. I just went in there and I said I'm going to play a Christian, and I'm going to debate the other side. I'm going to be the other side. I'm going to go in there and pretend to be a Christian theist and do what I can do here. And I mean, I was sowing discord for a little while there. Just sort of, seeing what could happen. And one of the reasons I stopped going to that room entirely was I realized, it isn't that there are people with bad arguments. These rooms are free-for-alls. Anyone can come in and say anything. It's that the people who were regulars, who knew better, would let people present bad arguments. I didn't like that. And what it used to bother me because I would go to these religious apologetics rooms, and I would see the same kind of thing. I'll have to say, though, to a greater extent, where these were essentially little safety zones where bad arguments were the operators would just let manifestly bad, fallacious arguments fly if they were from one side but not the other. And so we have a tendency to shelter people who agree with our conclusions, and that's the side I don't want to be on. The people who do that, I want to be on that side. I want it to be sort of able to criticize people who share my conclusions. With respect to Dr. Jones, your plea for help, I have to say one thing you can do. I mean, maybe on some of these shows, get some of the heaviest weight Bible scholars you can. Bart Ehrman is someone who does a lot of public talks, writes books for lay readers. His work is incredibly accessible. Yeah. Well, he's in high demand, of course. So it might be all nigh impossible. But someone like that. He's surely not the only name out there. There have to be others, of comparable character who are less well known and less in demand. But I mean, these people really know their stuff, of course, and they can help sort of undermine and shake people out of their conviction that this book was practically written in English, by God himself. There's so much superstition about the book, and it functions like a magic book. I mean, I watched a video of a fellow some weeks back who was trying to make a decision, and he was trying to decide on a course of action. And in his video, MK Skeptic knows who I'm talking about, in his video, he used his Bible like it was a magic eight ball. He said a little prayer, mm-hmm. about what course of action he should take, and then he flipped through his Bible, and then he just read a passage, and then he was going to sort of, like reading chicken entrails or something, that was going to construe that, and then that was going to reach make his decision for him. And like this Ouija board, magic eight ball approach to the Bible, it's so common, but that tells you people think that this is a magic book. And so, of course, when you say, you have to look at it in terms of the language and historical context and stuff like that, they think, no, divine providence saw to it that these words have come down to me. So it doesn't matter what the history is and what the languages are and the yeah. problem of translation yeah. interpretation. That's nothing to them. They think that magic has smoothed over all these problems.
And you know, I think a good response.
So I think that
A good way to deal with that is sometimes. I know part of what got to me was this. In studying linguistics, I didn't study linguistics in a biblical context. I studied it in other contexts, and I discovered in issues that didn't affect my religion the problem of language.
Right.
And once I had learned to embrace that, and of course I take that back to my Bible, I begin to say, holy crap, this is just not working, you know. And you know, and I, of course, I fell in love with linguistics as even as a teenager. And I my first choice, if I could have done it, would be to go to the University of Chicago. You know, out of high school, but it was beyond me to afford a place like that. But it was really, you know. So I think that part of the way that Dr. Jones and I, in trying to clean up this side of the aisle, it would be to use examples that were non-biblical. To try to communicate the reality of the problem language. And once people can buy into that as reasonable and see examples of it that are clear, that are non-threatening to some of their worldview, then suddenly it kind of like, once they embrace that, there's no way they can then go back to this text without beginning to, even if they think it's an exception, after a while they begin to see, no, it's not an exception.
Okay. Now, this is the way that you guys, and all of you guys, I want you to comment on this. You guys can help me with this. I made a statement, I think it was a week ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, on one of my shows. I was teaching, and I made this comment, got a lot of hell from many people, mostly theist, well, all theists, about this. And I simply said, if we had the best translation in the world with no errors, that doesn't mean that we need to accept what the ancients stated as truth. And I'm convinced that I don't care if Jesus said it, that it doesn't mean that it's true. And I think that theists are convinced that if person number A, B, or C out of the Bible says something, it's just truth. And how can we get people to walk away from that notion? In other words, just because Paul or Jesus or someone else might have said X, Y, or Z, how can we get people past the notion that people are infallible, that is, with their
words? How did we walk away, Dr. Jones? How did we walk away? We walked away from that.
We did. In fact, someone asked me to describe my journey out of the tragedy of my theism, soon I will do so. I want to discuss it. I would like to do several shows on it because there were various things that were compelling to me to walk away from it all. And I didn't just change 80% of what I thought to be true. I did a 360. So that's another show. But I would like your help on trying to encourage people away from the notion of everything in this book is believable. And in Ozzy, you made a powerful statement. You know, you like to read the Bible. There are some meaningful things in there that you can embrace and agree with, but not all of it, except, you know,
it's not like they were all stupid.
Yeah, you know, have the, the honesty to say, I can agree with this or I disagree with this, and treat it like a book. That's all it is.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's really hard because they don't, as I said, they don't think it's a normal book. They don't think it's literature. They think it's scripture. They have a special word for it, and that word sacralizes this set of pages. When you say something like, well, you know, even if Jesus said it, I don't know it's true. The name Jesus, you know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I mean, Jesus has the value of truth for them, right? I mean, they will even say this, that Jesus is truth and God is truth. You know, and they'll say God is beauty and God is love. you know, it's hard to understand. What do you mean when you say something is something else? I mean, you can only mean that figuratively, or you mean that it's a property. You can't mean that they're identical. But for some religious people, to say that God, that, you know, Jesus is truth, they mean it. I mean, they think, no, these things are practically synonymous in the sense that if it came out of Jesus' mouth, or if he did it, that this is normative. And you, so no, you got an uphill battle there. I don't think that you can, by pointing to anything in the text, just disabuse them of that. You'd have to get them to sort of see a flagrant contradiction that they couldn't harmonize. But, you know, if you're sufficiently motivated to harmonize, you can harmonize anything.
Right.
I once heard a guy say that he fell out of his faith, and it started with someone pointing out that the number of horses or stables that Solomon had, you know, and that are two different values right. given in two different yeah. books or something right. like that, and that this contradiction, it was numeric. There was no way to reconcile this in his mind. Now, you know, I'm sure that there is somewhere out there some way to reconcile this. But that, for him, did it. You know, I mean, and this is a person who fended off a million such contradictions. So I don't know what the secret is. I mean, you really have to ask yourself how you found your way out of it and how others find their way out of it. It just seems to me that it can't be just by pointing out contradictions. That's just going to be hit or miss. Yeah. Right. As a strategy, then it seems to me not going to be effective. Well,
getting to know people, getting to know who they are, discovering, you know, I mean, one of the things we do here is we try to bring theists and atheists together. How can I think that there is any significant difference in the quality of your life and the quality of mine? We talk with each other, we struggle with ideas, we try to find words to say that express ourselves. Where is the difference, you know? And I think that, you know, in trying to engage these people, I think we need to engage them or go bowling with an atheist or something, you know, spend time, dude. Just get to know people, you know, and that changes for a moment the context, because too many theists are very isolated socially. They're socially right. isolated. Got to get them out of yeah. that, you know. And
I think that's part of the reason why the atheist channels tend to be so aggressive is because yeah. many of them are isolated. I just yeah. want to put that little bit out there.
I learned to avoid any of those forums that were filled with college freshmen.
We are at the end of our show. We have run completely out of time, but I want to state that having all of you guys on here has been awesome. MK, you did a wonderful job tonight. We so enjoyed your okay. thoughts concerning Christmas and miracles. I wish we could have gone further, and your statements on miracles. We want to have you back soon, by the way. You're an awesome person. Pleasure. You have so many things to share. I could learn so much from you. And so can you share something that would really, really be beneficial to us all before the show ends?
Don't take Christmas too seriously. Enjoy it.
That's good. That's good. Ozzy, as you know, you always do. You always seem to touch our hearts. You seem to know how to say things in a way that gives us reason for change. And I think what you were saying a while ago about, you know, my side. I think you and please don't let me read into what you're saying, but I guess I'm going to anyway. It seems like you're just siding with something that's meaningful, reasonable, etc. Is that true?
Yeah. But I was, in fact, equivocating there. So I have to sort of own up to that. Sometimes when I was saying my side, I meant atheist, and sometimes I meant theist in part of that. But then I switched without acknowledging that I was doing that, and I was talking about the side of reason and the side of unreason, the side of people who are committed to honesty and rationality. You know, there's nothing more sacred than the facts, in my view. And we're all desperate to know the truth. And it seems to me that all we can try to do, whether we're theists or atheists, is, you know, is just honestly admit where our epistemological limits are, where the limits of our knowledge of what we know and the basis of what we know. And we've got to sort of stop doing this thing. And when we all do it on both sides, religious and secularists alike, we all just sort of, we all think that there's a better foundation, that there are better reasons just out of our grasp, just at the back of our minds, and that we can almost articulate them, we think. And that if we're pressed, we could pull them out of our back pocket and defend our moral beliefs. No, we can't. We're terrible at that. And people devote their lives to this in philosophy departments, in classics departments, in history departments, political science departments, I mean, you know, theology departments, and we're terrible at this. And we would just get so much further if we could just sort of just say, yeah, okay, you know, I believe the Bible because honestly, this is what I was told. Or, you know, I believe in reason and I think all that stuff is bunk. And yeah, I'm not really sure if I can defend reasoning with my reasoning. You know, things like that, it would go so much further. The other side just warms it up and feels better that you've given in a little bit. And they soften and then you can get a little further in the conversation. And you don't have to get much further every time, but you just get a little further each time with that person. It's great, and it becomes a habit. It gets easier with time.
You know, from talking to you from time to time, it seems like you're convinced that, you know, meaningful community is where it's at. It's not so much about the debate. It's about people coming together and really trying to wrestle with these concepts because, you know, many times we're talking about, you know, words with this usage, and then we switch and go back and forth. But it takes time to get to know each other. And this is one of the things that I love about the New Covenant group. We like to spend enough time getting to know each other, and we try to be kind. We try to be patient. We try to do lots of listening. And this is something that you have already excelled in, and we thank you for that. And so if I can ask you once again, can you encourage people out there to move forward? That is, in the sense of trying to find a meaningful place of community. Because I'll be honest with you, if people stay in church, they're going to stay around a lot of superstition. They're going to stay around a lot of things that are going to distract them, and they're going to stay stuck in fixed belief. But if they can find something else, something that would encourage them to move into another kind of community, a community that would be healthy for them, that would be great. And so what could you say to people about moving into that kind of community?
Well, I would say that you know, if you're interested in these kinds of discussions, you know, you can go to the forums and you can go to the chat rooms and you can go you know sort of YouTube videos and stuff like that, admire yourself, you know, a lot of people's views who agree with you. And that will reinforce and maintain and preserve your belief and sort of, you know, shore up what you already believe. Okay, well, that's fine. We all have a tendency to do that. But the thing is, those conversations get really boring. And I know so many people who have been at this for a long time who are weary, and they get exasperated by hearing the same old arguments, and they get, you know, impatient with having to recite the same old objections and stuff like that. And the thing to do is move into another community, move to another venue where people have different opinions, but there you're likely to see them again and again and again, and talk to them. And so it's the thing that I find most attractive about the New Covenant group. So I would encourage people to, you know, come here, give this a try, take a look. You know, this is a place where people are encouraged to talk and share their ideas and disagree openly and meet in hangouts, which is much warmer, and you can establish a relationship with a person. And you're asked, just don't try to convert or deconvert people. Just debate your ideas. And you might change your mind. You might not. They might change their minds, and you'll feel great if you help somebody change their minds. It always feels better to change another person's mind than change one's own mind for some reason. But even though we should all be ecstatic when we discover that we've been wrong and we, you know, we find out something else is true, we should all be ecstatic that we no longer have to operate under error. But it always feels better when you change another person's mind. But if you go to a new venue where you can actually forge a bit of a personal relationship with people who agree or disagree, it's so much better than the anonymity of you know, just attacking other people and being attacked and stuff like that, and having your own views reinforced. So
Right. That's
one of the things I've enjoyed about the New Covenant Group. Since I've injected myself into this whole discourse on the internet, the New Covenant Group has been sort of a very rewarding for me, because I've gotten to talk to these people, and you know, there's people of every level of education, every degree of openness. There's some people who are very, very closed, I find, but on both sides of this theist-atheist divide, and there are people who are incredibly open, and there's this whole spectrum in between. And I think as long as you're just not out to dominate another person and make them change their mind and throw your toys out of the pram because you didn't succeed, if you're not that kind of person, then this might be the place for you. Give it a try. You can have some good conversations here. I found it very rewarding.
Wow. You always knock the ball out of the park, don't you? That was awesome. Christopher Mowdy, we call you the Almighty God. and you always wow us. So give us something to go home on.
Well, I think that the point that's going to be driven home for me from tonight's discussion, in addition to the talk we had about Christmas and miracles, which I thought was awesome, I thought all of tonight's discussion was great. It was really stimulating. I really liked the way that everything came together. But the fact that we do have to be stewards for our own position, in the sense that, engage in what I think I heard Ozzy call policing of, you know, of people that, you know, label themselves the same way that you do, but try to take it to maybe a level that would besmirch the very label that the two of you are underneath, right? And I think that that's great. I mean, because the main point that he brought up is if we're not going to do it to one another, atheist to atheist or whoever to whoever-ist, hearing it from the other side is definitely not going to work. Hearing a theist tell an atheist, oh, I see what you're saying, but you're getting the argument all wrong for these reasons. As true as that might be, it's not going to be received the same way as an atheist telling an atheist, oh, I see what you're saying, but your argument's a little flawed in these areas, right?
Well,
it's just going to come across completely differently. So I think that there definitely needs to be a place in the landscape of what we're talking about here to have people, like Ozzy is saying, holding people, you know, responsible for not poisoning the well. And I think that that's true on both sides, because I think that that's when that happens, what he's ultimately talking about is raising the level of conversation.
Exactly.
And in raising the level of conversation, you know, we can kind of do away with the level of the kind of conversations that go on the forums where the freshmen in college go to. Because they're just practicing their arguments. We've done that. We don't want to have to put out something articulate and well thought out and have the response be something from somebody who doesn't understand where we're going with it.
Cool story,
and
bro.
Say that again.
Cool story, bro.
Yeah, exactly. That was perfect. So I'll wrap it up with that. It was a cool story, bro. And we want to avoid people who like are listening to, you know, what we think is a well articulated, well thought out argument, and that is their response. So I think that it raising the level to that raising the conversation to that level benefits everybody.
Sure.
I so agree. Bob, you're always the amazing Bob around here, and you have done awesome shows, and we're so thankful to have you on the place time and time again. So give us your best thoughts about tonight.
You know, I really enjoyed the conversation. I thought we had a great number of excellent insights shared by everyone around. You know, and I find that there's no need for any of us to give up that which for us is the most coherent. But I tell you, I'm at a point where I'm not really interested in being compelling necessarily. I'm not interested in even defending my views. I'm just interested in kind of putting them out there and having other people put that out there so that we can just kind of let it do the work that it does. And in the warmth of the conversation that we can have with each other and enjoying each other as we do, the truth is a lot of the changes we're going to experience will be the changes that come to us in those quiet moments when we're not here, when we're sitting there and thinking and experiencing the life that comes at us on a daily basis, and we find ourselves incorporating some of the things that we've heard. We slowly change. And it reminds me of what Jim Palmer had been talking about many times, that in the end, even if we don't remove the different assumptions that we come from, we can at least erase these artificial lines that keep us from being friends, keep us from having meaningful dialogue. And we need to continue doing this. And I also want to agree here with what Chris is saying, that as a theist, I really feel a strong responsibility to confront what I see in some of the theistic views, but I want to do that in a non-hostile way. I want to do that in a way that demonstrates that there's care, concern, a desire for honesty, a desire for truth and rational approach. I'm concerned about, you know, making sure that we in the New Covenant group can really facilitate a shift of theism, but also a new sense of community, that we are human, we are humanity, we are people, and we are we're in this together in a very real way, and I think that is the most enjoyable thing that I know of in life, that we are in this with each other.
That is awesome, to say the least. Tonight I need to remind you that if you would subscribe to YouTube, this helps us to connect to each other, and we certainly will subscribe to your YouTube channel. We want to have a discussion. We want to have a meaningful discussion. We want to move forward together. We see no advantage of just people becoming tribal in a sense. We think that having these open discussions, we can move as one, as humanity, and respect humanity. And so it's been fun, once again, being here at the place. And so you guys have a good evening. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.